not understand airplanes. They did not understand phones, cellular phones, and beepers and these type of things. It's very difficult. There's a hadith that says, in the end of time, and this is a sound hadith, in the end of time, a man would leave his house. يخرج المرء من بيته فتخبره فخذه بما أحدث أهله من بعده. A man will leave his house and his thigh will tell him what was happening in his house after he left the house. Now we know in the language of the Arabs will call something by a thing that it's attached to. In other words, if somebody had a phone on their thigh, then the Arabs could actually say, أخبرته فخذه. And he means the thing that was on his thigh. This is very common in the Arabic language, to call a thing by a thing that is near, or to call a hole by the part. اشتعل رأسه شيبا. His head, it literally says his head turned gray in the Quran, Zakariya alayhi salam. But it wasn't his head that turned gray, it was his hair. But the Quran uses the whole to indicate the part. So this is part of the Arabic language. So he also said that a man, the shiraku na'lihi satukallimuhu, the strap, the thong of his sandal will speak to him. He said that the jamadat, that inanimate things would speak. There's a saying, it's not a hadith, but it's mentioned centuries ago in the books. إِذَا نَطَقَ الْحَدِيدُ وَسَادَ الْعَبِيدُ وَقَرُبَ إِذَا نَطَقَ الْحَدِيدُ وَسَادَ الْعَبِيدُ وَقَرُبُ الْبَعِيدُ فَانْتَذَرَ الْوَعِيدُ. This is something I've seen a long time ago. When metal speaks, and the slaves, the low people rule. And this is from that, they're taking it, drawing it from the hadith, this proverb. They're drawing it from the hadith. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, in the end of time, the lowest people would become the rulers. The lowest people would become the rulers. And he said in a hadith, لا يزال الناس يغربلوا. The people will continue to be sifted out by a sieve. Do you say sieve here? Sieve? Huh? Sieve? The people be continued to be sifted out by the sieve until لا يبقى من الناس إلا الحذالة. That nothing remains of people except the dregs, the stuff you throw out. Right? And this is one of the signs of the end of time. The Prophet ﷺ said, لا تقوم الساعة حتى يكون أسعد الناس لكع بن لكع. The end of time will not come until the happiest of people is لكع بن لكع, which is an Arabic expression for somebody who has nothing, no origin, no nasab, no ird, nothing. He's just a low لكع بن لكع. That's what the Arabs say, لكع. Like he's worthless. And this would be one of the signs of the end of time, when you have people uneducated prancing about the earth. These rock stars, movie stars, the lowest type dregs of the society, prostitutes and these type of things. They become happy. They become the wealthy people. They become the ones, all these things. This is one of the signs of the end of time. That metal would speak and these low people would become the rulers. And he said, and the far would become near. You see, for instance, to fly from the United States, it take you 12 hours from California, 12 hours. This is a journey that took years, literally years, not that long ago, less than 100 years ago. It would take you a very long time to make. Now people complain, the plane's late, it's a half hour late. People complain, like people with these machines, like people that work at their school on a 486, you know, computer line. Have computers come to England yet? No, I'm just kidding. American think they're, you know, that it's all happening there, and everybody else is in the Stone Age. And this is the Stone Age. You know, Rajim means stoned. Everybody's stoned now, right? But this computer they have is a 486. If they get used to it, they go home and they have a 286, what they call a dinosaur now, right? Because it's like 2 years old or something like that. And then they complain and kick it because it's too slow, right? I mean, this is the thing. Or the photocopy machine. It used to take people hours to transcribe a piece of paper. Now they kick the photocopy machine because this is all part of the disease of the end of time. There's no sabr. People have lost sabr. So the farness and nearness, the far thing becomes near. You can go now to Mecca from the ends of the earth and be there in a few hours. A trip that people used to take with great difficulty and oftentimes risking their lives. From Morocco, they would have to go and pass through some treacherous places where they had brigands, Muslim brigands, right? Qutaa al-Turuq, things like this. Very difficult for people to travel. Now they get on a plane and they go. And it's interesting because Allah's deen by its nature is tamhis, purification. In the old days, they got on a plane, they got on the caravan and it was a punishment. The whole way of going to Hajj was in preparation. And so people had a very difficult time. When they got there, the Hujjaj, the people living in Mecca used to come out of the city. And they would vie over the Hujjaj to get them to come and stay in their houses. This is the way. So once you got to Mecca, suddenly you were in paradise. People who had, now we see photographs, pictures of Kaaba. People who'd never seen Kaaba. And suddenly they were in Mecca after spending a year on a very arduous journey. And they were in Mecca and the people of Mecca were embracing them, feeding them, taking care of them. Now, the adab is easy to get there. Once you get there, then all the problems start. You see, it's the opposite now. It's the exact opposite. You spend 4 days in Hajj and the Muslim, it's unbelievable. The adab. And it just indicates our state as an ummah. The five prayers each day indicate the state of the ummah, right? In the community level. The local neighborhood. You see who prays at Fajr, who prays at Isha. It lets you know how the neighbor, the health of the neighborhood. And then you see Jumu'ah, lets you know the health of the community, how your community's doing. But Hajj lets you know how the Ummah is doing. It gives you an indication of the entire Ummah of Islam. By the end of Hajj, you're literally walking on a foot of garbage. This is our contribution. A foot of garbage. They used to put garbage can. When I first went on the Hajj, they put garbage, huge garbage can. Nobody would ever use them. So the Saudi, they just said, just forget it. Why waste the time? Now they just come at the end of it with bulldozers and bulldoze all of the garbage. Right? And this is the state. But it's okay, you go to McDonald's. Now McDonald's in Mecca. You go to McDonald's, you have your McDonald's hamburger, throw the paper on the ground, right, with the golden arches. And Colonel Sanders, outside of Bab Abdulaziz, both names are problematic. But this is the state of the Ummah. So all of these things are happening, and amazing things. I mean, we're living in fascinating times. There's a Chinese curse, may you live in interesting times. Right? We are living in very interesting times because there's extraordinary change happening in this Ummah. Phenomenal. At rates that become like the computer. It literally boggles the imagination and the mind. So this idea of the second, to get back to it, this idea of Masih al-Dajjal. The Masih has the idea of the Anointed One. The one who was anointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Messiah of the Jewish people, which we believe and confirm is the position of Isa alayhi salam in Ulul Azmi and from the great Anbiya and Rusul, that he was given this position to call Bani Israel, the lost sheep. I was only sent for the lost sheep of the tribe of Israel. That sounds like it's a valid piece of the Injil. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. All of their, we would call those hadith matruk, hadith mawdu'. We don't know what they are. Like in the science of hadith, we have isnad. They don't have isnad for the Injil. So this group that was living at that time called the Ebionites, they were Jewish Christians. And these people were wiped out. Now Hans Kuhn, who is a German theologian, he's Catholic. The Catholic Church has accused him of heresy and different things. Hans Kuhn wrote a book called Christianity and the World Religions. He has a section on Islam. In this section, he admits that we must come to a fact that Jewish Christianity, which disappeared in the Quran, in the Arabian Peninsula. Some of the Christian scholars, in order to deal with this, have said there must have been Ebionites that were living in the Arabian Peninsula and they leaked this information to the Prophet Muhammad. Fled during the persecution to the Arabian Peninsula. They have no historical evidence for this. None whatsoever. And yet this is their claim. So he admits this, Hans Kuhn. And in the end, after explaining